This time on The Procedure.
The human heart. Roughly the size of a clenched fist, this vital engine supplies nourishing blood to all corners of the human body. The heart is powered by coronary arteries that lie on its surface. If these arteries become blocked due to plaque or calcium, it can lead to a heart attack or even death. For much of human existence, there was no treatment for coronary heart disease. Heart patients were subjected to a life of bed rest, simply waiting to die. But thanks to pioneering physicians, surgical options began to appear in the late 1950s. Bypass surgery started repairing vascular issues outside of the heart. The invention of the heart-lung machine made performing bypass surgery possible on the heart. And by the late 1980s, balloons and stents emerged as a new non-invasive treatment alternative. Today, these endovascular devices are still being refined, techniques perfected. A giant leap has taken place in imaging that has allowed doctors to visualize and understand this disease even better. And for the first time in history, doctors are finally understanding and appreciating how the disease can manifest differently in women and among various social and racial demographics. Join us as we take you into the endovascular lab so you can see these new technologies and techniques firsthand. Advancements that are changing a death sentence to a new lease on life.
All of a sudden, I started sweating. And I thought, uh-oh. I said, okay, Diane, let's go. We gotta get some help, because I remember my dad sweating like this. I need to get some help. Something's going on. And we didn't even call 911. Get me there as soon as you can. And I was in there for about 10 minutes answering their questions. And all of a sudden, my eyes rolled right back in my head. And I was gone.
Two first responders who happened to be in the emergency room saw his eyes roll back in his head, and he suffered a cardiac arrest. And it was amazing. They just jumped right in. They didn't hesitate, they didn't wait. We had started doing CPR in the emergency room, and these two first responders came with us up to the cardiac catheterization laboratory, because we didn't have a full staff there yet, and they did CPR on this patient who was completely flatlined with no blood pressure and no pulse for over 45 minutes.
Most patients that have cardiac arrest and have a rhythm that is a flatline or asystole usually die.
I think within the context of this being the first anniversary of 9/11, they knew their brethren in New York didn't quit, and they weren't going to quit. They were dripping wet, they were sweating, they were exhausted, they were fatigued, but they didn't stop. They weren't going to give up on this patient. It was truly one of the most amazing things in my professional career to witness.
If you've ever done 5 minutes of CPR, you would understand how exhausting it is to do 45 minutes of CPR. I was a soccer player during my college years, and 45 minutes is an entire half of a soccer game. So doing CPR for 45 minutes is pretty remarkable.
As we moved along in the case, after about 45 or 50 minutes, all of a sudden, we saw a blip on the screen. And then one blip was followed by several more, and we realized we had a rhythm back, and before long we had a blood pressure back. And as he began to stabilize, I wish you could have seen the look on those two first responders. They were elated, they were ecstatic. I think the fact that it was 9/11 was all the more special for them.
I just feel fortunate that I'm even sitting here right now. Because if it wasn't for Dr. Reiser and those two paramedics, I would not be sitting here right now. The one paramedic came up to my room, and I really wanted to thank him. I actually wanted to, you know, take him out for dinner or whatever. He said, no, this is what we do. And he said, we're just going to leave it at that.
What an amazing story that Jerry was going to die 16 years ago, but he's had a whole new life since then.
from the time that I was released from the hospital up until now, which was 16 years, I've been able to actually see all three of my grandchildren. I would have never been able to see them at all, and they never would have been able to see their, you know, their grandfather if I didn't make it.
This has given him a second opportunity at life. This reads like something out of a Hollywood screenplay. In my own personal career, this is not something that I could ever anticipate happening again. This is beyond what we normally expect from anybody providing CPR.
Some of us are extraordinarily fortunate that the right people are around at the right time. And I think in Jerry's case, that was definitely the moment to have two people like the firefighters help him, as well as one of the best cardiologists in the country right there to help him as well, I think are the keys. And then it can show that, you know, even people who are critically ill, if we give them a chance and they recover, they can go on to enjoy great things in their life and even accomplish more than they ever thought was possible before.
I have no problems. The stent is still in me, the same stent. I just been enjoying life. I look at life a lot differently in this past 16 years because of this situation. This was a big awakening as far as my life was concerned.
Welcome to another procedure with Dr. Ryzik and his wonderful team here. Doctor?
If you look at the screen, Brad, you can see the blockage that we're looking at. Could we get a stop action with the artery completely full? We are injecting contrast. Now toggle back, perfect. That's contrast that we've injected in the artery, and you can see that this artery, this right coronary artery, is a C-shaped artery, and right in the middle of the C, you can appreciate there is a blockage. When you compare that area of blockage to what we see high up in the vessel and more distal in the vessel, that's about a 90% blockage.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is a really important artery because it feeds all of the blood to the bottom of the heart. And so we really want to make sure that that bottom of the heart gets enough blood flow.
So what we're going to do, we're going to proceed with first ballooning it, dilating it. We showed you what stents look like. We're going to stent it in a minute. That stent is a scaffold. It's like a spring on an ink pen. And we're going to scaffold the vessel open. And then we're going to bring Dr. Padalia out here to do some imaging to show what the vessel. We were looking at the vessel from an X-ray on top. This is the X-ray tube. And we're looking at it from an X-ray outside the chest. Dr. Padalia is going to show us what it looks like from inside the vessel with what we call optical coherence tomography, or OCT.
So with that, that is where you're going to go in and you're going to actually open that up so it can start flowing more. Now, is there actual blood flowing right now, but not as much? Is that what the problem is?
Now it's blood flowing through there, but if this gentleman were to go jogging, he would when the heart rate increases and you need more blood, what would happen?
So when you need more blood and there's a blockage, there's not enough blood flow that can go through there, and then people can get chest pain, shortness of breath, feel like they can't do as much. And so that's why it's really important to fix these blockages when they're severely tightened.
What causes these blockages, doctors?
Wow, complicated formula. First of all, it's about fat and cholesterol, plaque, but that's only part of it. Coronary disease is about inflammation, and people develop an inflammatory process. They develop inflammation inside the blood vessel, and that can predispose. The older you are, the more calcium you may have, diabetes, smoking. It's a complex cascade of events which leads to the development of disease. And in his case, he had four arteries blocked. This would have been a quadruple bypass.
Absolutely. And that would have been something that would have had a long recuperation period.
And let's remind people, before this actual technology right here, you guys were actually going into opening up the chest and the heart to do this type of surgery.
In the old days, most of these types of procedures were bypass, were open chest procedures, and now we're going into the wrist. So, now, because there is calcium in this artery, we're going to do something unique, something new. You know how when a person has a kidney stone, doctors can use lithotripsy, shockwave lithotripsy, to break down the calcium? Dr. Shaw, when you see calcium here, what does that mean when you try and do an angioplasty or a stent?
So that makes it more difficult. So you can imagine if you're putting a balloon or a stent into something that's very rigid, it makes it more difficult to put in that stent. And then sometimes if you don't treat that calcium well in advance, you don't get as big of a stent that you can put in there. And that leads to an increased risk for a reblockage or a stent that's not completely opened up. And so that's why it's really important to, one, recognize that there is calcium, and then, two, try to treat that calcium in advance.
So it's sort of like bone growing into the arteries. So what Dr. Shaw is going to do is he's going to advance a lithotripsy balloon, and we're going to administer shocks inside the vessel to try and modify that calcium, to open that calcium. Go ahead, advance it. And that's our balloon. It's, of course, it's in a deflated state.
Looks like it's close to where we want it
to
be.
I think that's perfect.
Wow.
Wow.
Bring it back.
Very good. Okay. Now Mallory's going to step in, and she is going to inflate the balloon, and I'm actually going to administer shocks or shockwave lithotripsy to the, ready? Go negative. Now, Brad, watch what we do. And go up to 4 atmospheres. And now you're gonna hear some shocks as we go in and try and pulverize the calcium.
Wow.
Now, you hear those beeps?
Yes. And I see the little piece moving there. Is that what we're seeing?
Now it's opened up. The balloon is opened up due to the shocks. Okay, and down, balloon down. Now we're gonna give a little bit of rest. We're gonna allow blood to go through the vessel again. We're gonna wait a second. And let's just give him a few seconds to recover from the first balloon inflation. And we're gonna do another lithotripsy run. Let me just inject a little contrast, go live. So, okay, come back just a hair. Perfect. All right, go back up.
Come up at 4.
There it is. Oh, there you hit it that time. That's great.
Wow.
So watch. We're gonna do one more after this. I think we'll do a series of 3. And balloon down, please. Okay, we've done 2 inflations. We're gonna let him rest. Sometimes what we can do is we can watch his EKG, and as we inflate our balloon, remember, we're obstructing flow, we're blocking flow into the vessel. And so they might have a little chest pain, they might have some EKG changes. That's perfect, Mullet, go up right there. We're gonna go up with the balloon again. You can see the balloon inflating.
Yeah.
And now, again, I'm administering shocks to the vessel. You did a great job. I think you hit it right on the money there, sir. And down. Okay, we're gonna take this balloon out. So, Floro, retrieve it. Is it down?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So now we're gonna take the balloon out of the vessel. So what we've done is we've pre-treated the blockage before stenting. We don't wanna wire. We don't want to try and put a stent in where there's an obstruction.
Right.
And so what we're going to do is take the balloon out now after pre-dilating it. We'll take a picture to show what a good job Dr. Shaw has done with his balloon angioplasty. And then the next thing will be to put a stent in.
And now with putting that stent in, that's going to leave it open, as you were saying. It's almost like pushing everything aside so it can move much.
That's right. It's a scaffold that will help to maintain the integrity of the vessel. When all we did was balloon angioplasty several decades ago, we could get the vessel open like this, but about 30, 40, even 50% of the time, the vessel would recoil and close, and the patient would have to come back for another procedure. Now with stents, the closure rates, especially, you know, with the Abbott stent, the Zient stent that we use, the closure rates are low single digits. They usually stay open.
So compared to our last procedure, this is moving kind of quickly. Is that just because of the type of surgery this is?
You know, it's the type of surgery it is. Dr. Shaw and I have worked together for many years. We know each other's movements. And so this is, you know, a lot simpler. So what we're going to do now is take another picture and see what the balloon has done. Wow.
Oh,
now,
my goodness.
That looks fantastic. Now, let me just tell you something.
Wow.
If the year were 1990, before we had stents, we would probably be slapping each other high five, walking off and saying, look how great this is.
Yeah.
Now, I want you to look. It looks better than it did but we're going to improve the result even more by putting that stent in. Now watch how much better of a result we can get. 3533, please.
Now I hear you calling out numbers a little bit. What are those numbers you're calling out?
Okay, so the stent, I said a 3533. That means the stent, when we dilate it, it's going to be about 3.5 millimeters in diameter and about 33 millimeters long. Now, when you zoom up on that, look at it in relation to my finger, that's the stent right there. That shows you just how small these coronary arteries are. Now, that's the difference between stenting and surgery. The surgeons use magnifiers to see. We magnify our picture on the X-ray with X-ray machines.
Yeah. Okay. Dr. Isaac, you want to talk a little bit about what's coded on the stent?
Great point. Well, yeah. Why don't you?
So, you know, historically, these metal objects are great in opening up arteries, but sometimes you can have tissue that forms on them over age and time and cause a reblockage. And so industry and innovation has been fantastic in finding actually a drug coating that can go on these metal objects that allows for less of a reblockage rate. So, in fact, it's decreased the risk of reblockage from about 20% down to less than 5% at times. So that's fantastic.
So initially, the stents were just metal, and now they're drug-coated metal. And what's very interesting about this is the initial drugs used were just chemotherapy drugs, the same chemotherapy drugs that we used in cancer chemotherapy to prevent cancer from cells from regrowing. This will help to prevent the cells from regrowing inside the stent and the stent closing. So we have this scaffold, which keeps the vessel open, and then these anti-inflammatory chemotherapy drugs to keep the vessel open. So Dr. Shaw has just advanced that. He's done it flawlessly. He's done a beautiful job.
And I want people to understand on your screen, when you see the two different black marks, that is the stent.
That is the actual
stent.
So understand,
that's the actual stent in there.
That's the borders of the stent.
And that helps us use X-ray to identify exactly where we want to put the stent. Wow.
So now look at the picture that we showed you before. I'm going to show you how the vessel looks now. That's perfect, Malik. That is absolutely perfect. Okay, so now watch what we do with the stent. This, as we dilate it, will end up, push the table away from me just a little bit. Away from me, perfect, perfect. So I'm dilating it slowly, and you'll see the stent, the balloon on which the stent is mounted, start to dilate. Now it's fully expanded and looks very good. All right, would you take a cine and let's
absolutely
show it? Okay, now look at that. So that is a lot bigger than what the blood vessel was after we just ballooned it. What Dr. Shaw is going to do now is he's going to withdraw the balloon, and the stent is still there. Now let's take a picture, shall we?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so with the stent in place, now watch what it looks like.
Wow.
Beautiful.
So go back pictures, and for the audience at home, go back. Now, this is what it looked like. It's still a little bit irregular. Go forward a picture. This is with the stent being inflated. Go forward another picture. With the stent fully inflated and in place, those irregularities are smoothed out. The vessel looks fantastic. Now, I said that the stent was going to do a better job. I think we can even do a better job. I told you the stent was a 3.5 millimeter stent. What we're going to do now is put a 4 millimeter diameter balloon, and now we're going to try and make the vessel oversized, because the more we oversize this, Brad, the less likely it is that our patient is going to come back with the vessel closed.
So are you putting another stent in? Or
we're going to put just a balloon and now expand this stent even more. So we had a stent on a balloon, we put the stent in place, and now we're going to put a larger balloon. We're going to go from 3.5 millimeters to 4.
Yeah, and everything's flowing much better. They're going to be able to move and exercise and be much healthier.
No question. So what Dr. Shaw has just done flawlessly, again, I might add, is he's put the balloon inside the stent. Why don't we take a cine to see where we're at?
Sure.
Run it forward. Okay, negative. So back just a tad. Okay, happy?
Yeah.
All right. So now we've got a balloon at 3.5, or a stent at 3.5 millimeters inside the artery, and now we have a 4 millimeter balloon that we're going to blow up and expand the stent even more.
Wow. For those watching at home, if you just saw what that happened, you saw the balloon open up a little more to the stent.
So now he's going to pull it back a little bit so that we dilate the entire stented segment. Go in just a tad.
Let me just sit in just a second.
I'd go in just a tad. Just a tad in. Perfect. Dr. Shaw and I have worked together for so many years. Sometimes we do this and we don't even talk.
Hand in glove. All
right. And now you see the balloon. Now you see that balloon expanded and it's expanding the stent. Okay. So I think the next step is for us to put a camera. Now you've seen all these pictures from an X-ray camera from on top of the patient's body. Now let's put a camera inside and see what it looks like inside the blood vessel.
Wow. So like what we were doing outside here?
Absolutely. What we showed you before we came in the lab.
So, wow, amazing.
So Brad, the number one thing that patients ask me all the time is how long will my stent last? And two things that Dr. Ryzik and the whole team are doing here, which are really crucial, are one, making sure to prepare the blood vessel extremely effectively with that shockwave technology that sort of actually opens up that artery with the lithotripsy. And then the second thing is to image it afterwards to make sure that the stent is perfect. Because if we want to make it just right now, and that decreases the chances of ever having to need another stent in the future.
So Brad, I'm pleased to introduce one of our colleagues and a close friend, Dr. Bimal Padalia. Dr. Padalia will be over here in a second, but Dr. Padalia, what is it that we learn from OCT that helps us to optimize these stents, to make these stents stay open or to be durable so that they don't close down?
That's a good question, David. So what OCT allows us to do, especially in 2020, is not to guess on the stent size anymore. It's like Goldilocks and the Three Bears. You want the stent size to be precisely right, not too small, not too big. And we know that through studies that when you do get it close to exactly right, it decreases the risk of further heart attacks in the future and problems with the stent.
That's a perfect explanation. So we have the OCT in. Fluoroscopy is great. We have used fluoroscopy for decades to look at these vessels. But fluoroscopy alone is not enough. There are limits to how well we can see the blood vessel with fluoroscopy. And as Dr. Padalia said, putting this tiny little infrared camera in really, really does give us more ability to image and to perfect the stent implant.
So how big is this little camera that's going in there?
About the same. It's smaller than the stents that we put in.
Wow.
Okay, let's do an OCT run. Ready? Tell me when you're ready. Hold it.
So I'm auto-calibrating. You purged Flush. A little bit. You're well engaged. Is that right, Malik?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Say that again, Bibble.
Yeah.
You're well engaged.
We are.
Yes.
Okay. We are. Yeah,
and
we are.
What's the assist on?
414, 300, 0. Zero rise. Okay. Are you okay with that?
Okay. Ready?
So this is how we get the OCT image.
I'm going to bring it back.
Enable pullback.
And if you'd fluoro save that for us. Okay, watch the rhythm. Okay, why don't you come back?
Good image.
Now, Dr. Padalia, I really want you to explain this because you explained this so well. Talk to us about the image we're looking at and the stent and whatnot. Tell everybody in the audience just exactly what you're seeing.
So we basically have put a very small camera into the artery. It's as if, you know, we've shrunk somebody, become like Ant-Man, and are swimming through the artery here. So on the left-hand corner, you can see the fluoroscopy or the X-ray image that we've been looking at. And then to the right, you're actually swimming through the artery going from the far part or the distal part to the proximal part, or near part. And these spokes that you see, these white dots, they kind of look like bicycle spokes. That's the actual stent that's been put in. And as we interrogate or look at this very closely, what we can see is how well did we place the stent in the right position and how big did we make it? Did we make it significantly large?
I'm sorry to interrupt you. And it's right up against the vessel wall, isn't it?
Exactly. The stents The metal part of the stent is right against the metal wall, which you can see right here. And then the important part is, how large did we make it? Did we make it sufficiently large enough? And these numbers in yellow here tell you that we're 99% expanded here, 87% expanded there. And we know that the studies show if you're more than 80% expanded, that you've done a very, very good job and that this stent may last the patient for a long, long time.
So all I did was talk. Dr. Shaw did all the heavy lifting. He expanded the stent. But what we can conclude from having this tiny camera inside, we can see things that we couldn't see with X-ray alone, and we can conclude, based on your measurements, that this is very, very unlikely to ever close, correct?
That is correct. This is how stents should be placed in 2021.
So if as long as this patient stays, now we just put a piece of metal in the artery, and so we're going to ask this patient to be on blood thinners, two blood thinning agents, for 6 months to a year. As long as he stays on those blood thinning agents, Dr. Shaw, chance of closing is low single digit.
The risk is very, very low if somebody's taking their medications regularly, which is great.
So let me ask, we just saw that imaging. Now, say for instance we got through and the numbers weren't right where they were supposed to be. Do you go back in and you maneuver so those numbers are just right?
Absolutely. We'd touch it up to make sure that we're expanded perfectly and go back in with the camera to make sure that we've actually done it perfectly as well.
Dr. Padalia, maybe you can talk about some of the upcoming artificial intelligence with this device, and it tells you just how much you should expand it, right?
Exactly. It's similar to having maps in the past and then having a map that talks to you and tells you exactly what to do. So the next level technology with this software, OCT, when you do a run, it will actually tell you what kind of plaque do you have. Is it lipid or cholesterol rich, or is it calcific, that you may need something like the shockwave that we used. And then number two, it will correctly measure the actual dimensions of the stent to tell you exactly what diameter and length stent to use.
So we might have used a 4-millimeter balloon with the next renditions of this, the next iterations of this, it might tell us you used a 4-millimeter balloon, now go up to a 4.5-millimeter balloon or a 5-millimeter balloon to optimize your results. So we get real-time feedback. It's nice to have Dr. Padalia, you know, in there. It's nice to have Dr. Shaw in here. But if I were here by myself, this would be giving me real-time feedback as to what the next steps are.
Wow, amazing.
So, wait a minute, you want to have some fun? Bimal, can you do a 3D? Look at this. So, Bimal, wow. Do a 3D rendering for us to show the kind of images you get with this.
Exactly. So let me make this picture a little bit bigger if I can. Here we go. So as we move through this vessel, and I'll zoom in here, you could see the actual wire that has been placed into the artery.
Just now, that's that tiny wire. Fluoro a minute. That tiny wire you see running the length.
Right.
Now show them the wire on the on your 3D imaging.
Right through here.
Yes.
This straight line.
Isn't that
line
amazing?
Here.
This small.
That
right here.
That is the stent, or is that?
That's just the wire.
That's the wire that we've been using.
That's the this. If
right
you can,
here.
If you yeah. can zoom in on the table. The wire that's running through the blood vessel is about as thick as one of our hairs on our head. And that's what you're seeing on the screen, that big wire running through the vessel.
That is so incredible that that little piece is what's pretty much
0.0014 millimeters.
Yeah, this is 14 thousandths of an inch, and that's what we can see.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, so now he's moving up, and we see the...
Now you see the stent. Part.
That's the stent.
So these struts is what we call it, is of the metal stent that was placed. And you could see on this 3D image that it's nicely hugging the wall of the artery
as well. Beautiful.
And that's what we really want to have.
That's what we want to have. Okay, we are going to take a final picture, and then I think we're going to take some questions.
Yes.
All right, let's see what we have. Last picture. Looks phenomenal.
Looks beautiful.
The chance of this closing is extraordinarily low, and I got to tell you, it is always...
It's my pleasure to work
fun
with you.
Fun working with you, Bimal. I always get a lot out of what you teach. Look at that other image that Dr. Padalia is showing us now. That's right down the barrel of the blood vessel.
The before and after is very impressive here.
Yeah. Wow.
That's the Ant-Man swimming through the artery.
There it is. Right there. All right. So we're going to take a final picture with all of the equipment out. Wow, that's beautiful. Look at
that. Gorgeous.